So this is the first chapter in the chemistry part after we have finished the physics part. That's chapter 14. And this is section 1, matter and thermal energy. In this section, we will know how the kinetic theory describes the matter and what are the states of matter, the solid, the liquid, the gas, and the plasma. The movement of particles in different states and how to change from one state to the other and what are the requirements for this change. The kinetic theory mentioned that matter is composed of very small tiny particles which are atoms or molecules or ions. In case of metals, for example, it will be the atoms. In case of liquids, it will be the molecules. And in case of plasma, for example, it will be the ions, as we will see. Molecule means juzay. Okay? These particles are in a continuous random motion. So the particles are always in a motion. They don't stop ever. Okay? They are always moving and always colliding with each other. When they move, they collide with each other. And this collision is responsible for exchanging the energy. So let's say if a particle has, for example, 6 joules of kinetic energy. Its kinetic energy is 6 joules. Another one has, let's say, 2 joules. And they will collide with each other. During the collision, there will be an exchange of energy. So the one with higher energy will give some of its energy to the other one according to the direction or collision, according to the masses, and so on. Anyway, so when they rebound back, let's say the first one will have a kinetic energy 5 joules. The other one will have 3 joules. So the total energy here, the total kinetic energy here is conserved between the collision or in the collision of the particles. The total energy is conserved. So the energy before collision is 8 joule, 6 plus 2. And after collision also 5 plus 3, it's 8 joule. So we have no loss during the collisions of particles. But the energy is transferred from one to the other. From which one to the other? The one with higher kinetic energy to the one with lower kinetic energy. And this is the main reason the energy is transferred through whatever matter, through the collisions. Okay? States of matter are solid, liquid, gas, and the plasma. What are the characteristics of solid? Solid has a definite volume and shape. It's non-changeable, so it's a definite volume and shape. Particles are tightly packed in a relatively fixed positions. So the particles will have fixed positions like this, for example. So they don't move and they don't leave their position. But you have just said that the particles are in a continuous random motion. That's right. So what kind of motion is this motion in the solid? In the solid, particles are allowed to vibrate about a fixed axis. Like this one, for example, it will vibrate to the right and to the left. Vibrate means it is as. Okay? So vibration, it is as. So it will vibrate to the right and to the left. Okay? The more the energy, the more the kinetic energy, the faster the vibration, and the higher the distance or the displacement from the reference axis or from the fixed position. The other one also will vibrate to the right and to the left. This one also vibrates to the right and to the left and so on. So when they vibrate, they will collide with each other. They will collide with each other and hence the energy will transfer from one to the other. Say this one has high energy. Let's say it's hot, so it will transfer the energy to the next one, which is a cold one, Okay, and so on, it will change, this energy changes to the others through the collisions. Okay. The particles are held together by strong attractive forces. So the forces in between, the forces, the attraction forces between all of them is very strong force. Okay. And not all the solids are the same. There are solids with stronger forces than the others, and so on. Point is, all of them, they have attraction forces toward each other. Okay? There are two types of solids. There is the crystalline solid and the amorphous solid. In the crystalline solid, the particles are arranged in repeating pattern. So particles, they are not random in the matter. No, they have certain geometrical shape. They have a certain geometrical shape. And this geometrical shape is repeated through the matter. Okay. For example, it might take this shape, a cube. So the particles will take the shape of a cube. It will be arranged as a cube. And this cube is repeated again and again and again in the three dimensions, okay? Sometimes it's centered, body-centered cubic. It has an atom in the center of the cube, okay? Sometimes it has atoms on the sides of the cube. The six sides, it has an atom in the center, okay? That's also a certain shape. It might be hexagon, like this one. It might be tetrahedral. So there are different geometrical shapes for the crystalline solids. Metals, usually they are crystalline solids. The metals, ice, sugar, salts, different types of salts, not the salt only that we eat, which is a table salt. Okay. Quartz, diamond. So all of these are examples for crystalline solids where the atoms, they are arranged, or the particles, they are arranged in a geometrical shape. Okay. The second part is called the amorphous. Amorphous solid is the opposite. The particles here are found in random arrangement. Random arrangement. Okay. In this case, we call it amorphous solid. They don't have any geometrical shape. Okay, but they are adjacent to each other randomly. For example, the rubber, glass, the wax, all of these are solids with amorphous, or we can call it amorphous solids, or it has random arrangement. Rubber, al-mattat. Wax is the candle. The candle, wax. Okay. Shama. And the glass, you know the glass. So the amorphous solid, in the amorphous solid, there is no definite temperature for melting down. Melting down means solid changes. Solid changes into a liquid. It's called melting. Okay? When a solid changes into a liquid, we call it melting. So there is no definite temperature, or there is no exact temperature at which this solid changes into a liquid, okay? But for the crystalline solids, there is a definite temperature for which the solid changes into a liquid. So for example, the temperature of melting of iron, the temperature of melting of iron. Iron is, in the normal cases, it's considered crystalline solids. So if you go to the tables of melting temperatures, you will find that it's around, I think if I remember, it's 1538 degrees Celsius. So this is the melting point, or the melting temperature of the iron, al-hadid. So it's an exact number, definite number. But for the glass, for example, glass doesn't have a certain temperature, but it has a range of temperatures. In this range, glass melts down. Okay, so there is no definite temperature. So usually the amorphous solids, they softens. Softens means yatra. So they softens into liquid over a range of temperature. So in this range, the glass softens, and then if you increase the heat, it will turn into a liquid. Okay. The liquids, the second one is the liquids. They have a definite volume, but not a definite shape. So all the volumes here are the same, but as you see, they have different shape according to the shape of the container or the shape of the vessel. Okay. The particles in the liquid are close together, but not very close like the solid. And they can move. They can move in groups. And their movement, we call it the flow. Flow, التدفق. Flow. So this is the motion of the liquids. The distance between the particles is larger than the solids, as we say. What about the attraction force? The attraction force in between is not very high like the solids, but also not very low like the gases. Okay. Usually solids, the particles are arranged randomly in liquids. So in liquids, particles are arranged randomly. Except in some kind of liquid, we call it the liquid crystals. Okay. In this liquid, it's actually an artificial liquid, some chemical compound. It's in liquid state, but the particles, they have geometrical shape. And because this crystalline shape, they have very good electrical properties. And they can use it in manufacturing the displays, the device displays. And we call it the LCD. LCD, the liquid crystals display. Liquid crystal displays, LCD. It's used in the screens of the laptops, screens of the computers and televisions, the cell phones, and so on. Okay. And I believe you hear this LCD, there is LED, and there are some plasma screens. In the LCD, they use the liquid crystal. The effective material here that emits the light is a liquid crystal, so it's liquid. Okay. The other one is called the LED. LED is like more modern one. Okay. LED is a solid. It's diode, some kind of diodes, semiconductors. Okay. It's called LED. The third one is the plasma. They use some kind of plasma to emit the light, and they use it as a screen. So I think these are the main, or maybe the only, if I know it well. Yes, Abdul Ilah.
The plasma is the substitute between the solid and liquid. I'm correct or no? Or liquid?
No. The plasma is something else. Okay, we will talk about the plasma now. Like, give us a minute. So these are the main types, or the main screen kinds. So the gas is the third one. It has no definite volume and no definite shape. It takes the volume and the shape of the container. Wherever you put it, it will take the shape and the volume of its container. And in the gases, the particles are moving rapidly in all directions randomly. Okay. The distance between the particles are much greater than solids and liquids. Attractive forces are much less than liquids and solids, and the kinetic energy of the particles, it can easily overcome this attraction force, so they can move everywhere inside the container. The plasma state. If there is a neutral atom, zarra, the atom has a nucleus, a positive nucleus in the center, and as you studied, there are electrons arranged around this nucleus. So that's called neutral atom. If you give enough amount of energy, if you give enough amount of energy to this atom, we can pull one of the electrons out. We can remove one of the bounded electrons, okay, out, so it becomes free electron. So it's not related to this atom anymore. Changes into an ion, a positive ion. Okay, so if you give enough energy to the atom, you can pull the electron out, or you can remove this electron out, and the atom changes into a positive ion. You can do that to many particles in the media. So you change the media into positive particles, which are the ions, and negative particles, which are the electrons. Like this, okay? So it's like the sea, and all these particles, they are swimming together in this sea. That's called plasma. So plasma is a combination of what? Positive ions and negative free electrons, okay? And they collide with each other. So the electron will hit the ion, and the ion will hit the electron, and so on. So they are separate. They are separate particles. They are not in the same particle anymore. This amount of energy, usually we get it from where? We get it from electric field, electric source. So we apply electric field, okay? We apply magnetic field. We might apply a beam of laser. So electric field or magnetic field or a beam of laser can excite this atom, and it can ionize the atom and pull one or more electrons out of the atom, turning the atom into an ion and free electrons. So this is briefly is the state of plasma. The plasma can be found in the nature, in the stars, because of the huge amount of energy in the stars. So all the particles are ionized. So you will find here positive ions instead of neutral atoms, positive ions and negative electrons. They are very dense, has very high density, كثافة عالية, very high density, and it's in the plasma state. Also, it happened on the Earth during the lightning. During the lightning, the clouds in the earth, in between there will be a huge potential, huge electrical potential. It reaches to millions of volts. That's an electric potential between the clouds and between the ground. Because there is a potential, so there will be a current, an electric current. It will be discharged through the air, causing this arc, which we call it the lightning bolt. Okay, because of there is an electric current, it has a huge amount of charge, so through the air, so it will ionize the molecules and the particles of the air into positive ions and negative electrons. So the lightning is considered as plasma. It can be done also in the laboratory, like in the fluorescent lamps or the neon lamps. In the neon lamp or the fluorescent lamp, there is a gas inside this lamp. And we apply a certain electric field through two electrodes. We apply an electric potential. This will ionize the gas in this lamp. It will ionize it, so it turns it into positive and negative, positive ions and negative electrons. So it changes the gas into plasma. this gas into plasma. And it's accompanied by emitting light. So usually, but not always, plasma is accompanied by producing light. So light coming from this fluorescent lamp, light coming from the lightning, light coming from the star, and so on. What is the heat? What is the temperature? Heat and temperature. First, we need to define what the meaning of thermal energy. Thermal energy. If you have multiple particles here, each particle moves with a certain kinetic energy. Kinetic energy. Let's say, for example, this one has 1 joule. This one has, of course, it has like less than that. But this one has 10 joules. This one has 15 joules. This one has 20 joules, and so on. So this is the kinetic energy, which is mv squared, as we have studied in physics. Okay. So for the particles also there is kinetic energy. Kinetic energy for each particle. And because of there is attraction force between these particles, so there is also a potential energy. Sorry, all the particles, they attract each other. Okay, so that means there is a potential energy. If we sum the whole kinetic energy, the total kinetic energy of all the particles, plus all the potential energy, that's called thermal energy. So the thermal energy is what? Is the total kinetic energy and the potential energy of all the particles. Of all the particles. Of course, the more the particles, the more the energy. If you have 10 particles, it's different from if you have 20 particles. Of course, the 20 particles, if they are the same, they will have more energy, because each one has a kinetic energy and it attracts the other, so there is also a potential energy, and so on. So this is thermal energy. What about the heat? Heat. Heat is an amount of thermal energy, a certain amount of thermal energy, which is transferred from one substance to the other. Substance means like matter, okay, like a material or something. So it's an amount of thermal energy transferred from a substance to the other. Always from the hot substance to the cold substance, because the hot has more kinetic energy than the cold. Okay, so heat is an amount of thermal energy transfers from the hot substance to the cold substance. Heat is an amount of energy, so it's measured in joule. Heat should be measured in joule. Guys, so when matter is heated, what will happen? It gains thermal energy. It will gain some amount of thermal energy. It gains heat. Also, when you leave it to cool down, when you leave it to cool down, it will lose or it will release some amount of heat. Okay? It will release thermal energy. So this is the thermal energy and the heat. What about the temperature? Temperature is a scale. It will tell you how hot or how cold is an object. How hot or how cold this object is. And actually, temperature, it's the average, measures the average kinetic energy of the particles. Average, not the total. Like let's say, for example, I have 4 particles. Or 5 particles. This one has 13 joule. That's an example, it's a real one. This one has 14 joule. This one has 15 joule. This one has 16 joule. This one has 17 joule. Okay? So what is the average kinetic energy of these particles? So you need to say 13 plus 14 plus 15 plus 16 plus 17 divided by the number. So it gives you the average is 15 joule. For example, the average will be 15 joule. So this is the average kinetic energy. It's different from the thermal energy, because thermal energy is the total kinetic and potential. That means you have to say 13 plus 14 plus 15 plus 16 plus 17 and so on. So this is total kinetic energy. So take care that thermal energy is different from the temperature. Temperature only it measures the average. The average, not the total. Okay. So the temperature should be measured also in joule. Should be measured in joule. But actually, there is some convenient scales or some convenient units that are used to describe the temperature, which are the Celsius, the Fahrenheit, and the Kelvin. So these are the common units of the temperature. And actually, we can change it into joule, by the way, if we want to change these amounts to joule, we just multiply it times a certain constant. There is a certain constant that we might discuss it later. When you multiply the temperature times this constant, it gives you the corresponding amount in joule. So it gives you the average energy in joule. Okay? What conventional unit are the Celsius that we use here in Saudi Arabia? The Fahrenheit, it's widely used, for example, in some countries like United States. And the Kelvin, this is a scientific unit. This is the SI unit, the SI unit for temperature, which you will find it in all textbooks of physics. So usually in all the equations or most of the equations that has the temperature, we use Kelvin. We use Kelvin. Sometimes we can convert it into Celsius, but usually we use the Kelvin. Okay? So this is the temperature. I hope you understand the difference between the temperature and the heat or the thermal energy. Here is average, and there is total kinetic and potential. Okay? Change of state. When there is a change of the state of matter, like from solid to a liquid, from liquid to a gas, or vice versa, that's called the change of the state. And when a substance changes from one physical form to the other, it must gain or release thermal energy. It must gain or release thermal energy, or heat, let's say it heat, some amount of heat. Let's discuss the first change. Number one, melting. الذوبان. Melting is a change of solid into a liquid. Like if you have a piece of ice, for example, you can leave it to melt down to become water. So for the solid or for the solid to change into liquid, there are two conditions. You have to fulfill conditions. So the solid will change into a liquid. What are these conditions? Number one, you have to raise the temperature of this solid to reach to the melting temperature, which we call it the melting point. As we said at the beginning, for the metals, for example, or for the crystalline solids, there is a certain temperature at which they melt down. So you have to raise the temperature of the solid so it reaches to this melting point. So the melting point is what? It's a temperature at which the substance changes from a solid to a liquid. The substance will be able to change from solid to a liquid when it reaches to this temperature. For example, for ice to change to water, it's 0 degrees Celsius. 0 degrees Celsius is the melting point of ice or for water. The iron, as we said 5 minutes ago, it was 1,508 degrees Celsius. I hope this is the right number. You can review it on the internet or from the tables. Okay, but I think it's this number, 1,538 degrees Celsius. Okay. So that's called melting point. So you have to raise the temperature of the material. For example, when you take the ice from the fridge, when you take some ice from the fridge or from the freezer, its temperature usually is negative 15 or negative 10 degrees Celsius. This is the original temperature of ice. So you have to raise the temperature of the ice until it reaches zero. So when you raise the temperature of ice until it reaches zero, at this point or at this time, the ice will be ready. The ice will be ready to convert or to change into water. But is it enough? No, it's not enough. This is the first requirement. The second requirement is what? After you reach to the melting point, you have to give some amount of energy to the ice. You have to give the solid some amount of energy. Why? To overcome the attraction forces between the atoms. We said between the parts of the solids, there is a strong force of attraction. You need to weaken this force. You need to overcome this force. So you need to give it a certain amount of heat, which we call it heat of fusion. So what is the heat of fusion? It's an amount of thermal energy required to change a substance from a solid state to a liquid state. But the condition, it must be at this temperature, the melting point. For example, the ice needs 333 joules per gram. For each gram of ice, you need an amount of heat, 333 joules. If the ice is at 0 degrees Celsius and you give it this amount of heat, it will change into water. This is for each gram. If you have 2 grams, for example, you have to give it 666 and so on. Okay? Freezing is the opposite of melting. Freezing at tajammud. So it's a change from liquid to what? To a solid. The opposite exactly. This must happen at a certain temperature. We call it the freezing point. What is the freezing point? It's a certain temperature at which a substance will change, okay, from the liquid state into the solid state. This freezing point has the same value as the melting point. The same value. So, for example, for water to change into ice, this will happen at 0 degrees Celsius. So it's a reverse of melting. Okay, and the freezing point has the same value as the melting point. One of the most important is the vaporization. التبخر, vaporization. What is it? It's a change from liquid to a gas. Liquid state to a gas state. Vaporization. The vaporization is accompanied by this phenomena which we call it the boiling. What is the boiling? If you have a vessel like this one and you put some liquid like water and you put a heater. So this is a heater. Let's say this is a source of heat. Like some fire or a stove or whatever. Okay. Because the source of heat is very hot, it will do what? It will increase the temperature of the wall of the vessel. So the temperature of the walls of the vessel will increase, especially the wall that's adjacent to the source of heat. This will cause some particles from the liquid to vaporize, will change into gas. The particles that's adjacent to the source of heat, because the source of heat is very, very hot. So it will cause some particles or some points here to change into gas. We call it bubbles. Bubble. فقاعة. So these bubbles are what? It's some liquid changes into gas. And because gas has lower density, it will move up. It will move up through the liquid. Okay? This is what we call boiling. So boiling is what? It's a kind of vaporization. It happens throughout the liquid, especially adjacent to the source of heat. And it will move move through the liquid until it reaches to the surface, and you will see it as vapor. Okay, so the vapor that you will see during the boiling, this is coming from adjacent to the source of. For the boiling to happen, you have to reach to a certain temperature. This temperature is called the boiling point. Boiling point. What's the boiling point? It's a temperature at which substance boils. For example, for water, it's 100 degrees Celsius. For the water, it's 100 degrees Celsius. This is the boiling point for water. The boiling point is related to the what? It's related to the pressure on the vessel, or the pressure on the surface of the liquid. When the pressure coming from the surface, the pressure of this vapor equals to the pressure of the atmosphere, this is at which the boiling will happen. So the boiling point, the boiling temperature depends on the what? The pressure. So it happens when the vapor pressure, the pressure coming from the vapor at the surface equals to the external pressure. Usually, which is, if it is an open vessel, it will be the atmospheric pressure. So if you increase the atmospheric pressure or the pressure on the vessel, this will increase the boiling point. And if you decrease the atmospheric pressure or the pressure on the vessel, or the pressure, let's say, on the surface, this will, if you increase it, you will increase the boiling point. If you decrease it, you will decrease the boiling point. For example, let's say at the sea level, the boiling of water is 100 degrees Celsius. Water will boil. If you take the water to top of mountain, at the top of the mountain, the atmospheric pressure is less. The pressure, as you know, when you go up, the pressure decreases. So if you go to at the top of a certain mount like Everest or something like that, the pressure will decrease. So if you have some water to boil, it will boil at lower temperature because the pressure decreases. So the pressure of the vapor equals the pressure of the atmospheric at lower temperature. Let's say it will boil at 90 degrees Celsius. For example, 90 degrees Celsius. Also, if you can increase the pressure, if you increase the pressure over the liquid. For example, if you have a pressure cooker, in the pressure cooker here, it does what? It tightens and isolates this liquid inside from outside. So due to the vapor inside, this will increase the pressure on the surface of the liquid. And when you increase the pressure, the boiling point will increase. So the point inside the pressure cooker will increase. It might be like 120 degrees Celsius or maybe more. So it's not 100 anymore. So the pressure can increase or decrease the boiling point. The more the pressure, the higher the boiling point. The less the pressure, the less the boiling point, and so on. Hey guys, so this is the boiling point. It's a temperature, the temperature at which the boiling happens and at which the liquid will change into a gas. But is it enough to reach to the boiling point? No, it's not enough. It's the first condition, but there is another condition. Similar to the melting. The other condition is you need to give some amount of thermal energy, which we call it heat of vaporization. Heat of vaporization. Why do you need heat of vaporization? To overcome the potential energy between the two particles. Between the molecules of the liquid, there are attraction forces. So we need to overcome this force. Okay, we need to reduce this force so we can remove the particles away from each other. So to reduce this force, you need to give some amount of heat. We call it heat of vaporization. So it's the energy required to change a substance from liquid to a gas, but it must happen at the boiling point. And it's measured also in joule per gram. Joule per gram. So it depends also on the amount of. That's why if you have a small vessel and you put some water, and if you have a big vessel and fill it with water and you put both of them on the stove, which one will take more time? What's the bigger one? Why? Because it needs more thermal energy. It will need more energy to increase its kinetic energy, and it will need more energy for the potential energy to overcome the forces between the particles. While the small one, maybe it will boil in a minute or 2 minutes maximum, because it will need less energy because it's small size. The energy depends on how much is the substance. You have, let's say, 100 gram here or 2 kilogram on the other side, and so on. There is another kind of changing liquid into a gas other than the vaporization. What do we call it? We call it the evaporation. Evaporation. What is the evaporation? It's evaporization. So it's a change from liquid to a gas. Change from liquid to a gas. It occurs at the surface of the liquid. So it does not happen. We said the boiling here, it starts at the source of the heat. Usually, if you put it on the stove, for example, it will start from the bottom. Okay? So it starts very near to the source of heat. While the evaporation, it occurs at the surface of the liquid. Okay? So there is no boiling here. Just liquid changes into a gas from the surface of the liquid. What about the temperature? It occurs at a temperature lower than the boiling point. So for water, for example, it might happen at 20 degree, at 30 degree, at 50 degree. Doesn't matter. Okay. So this is called evaporation. Evaporation. Like if you put some water in a plate, something, and you leave it outdoor, leave it in the sun or outdoor, wherever you put it, leave it for a few hours. And you come back, you will find it. Why? Because it evaporates. Evaporates means it to gas, but this happens at the normal temperature, whatever the temperature, 30 degree, 40 degree, doesn't matter. This is a very important process because it happens in the seas and the oceans. In the surface or at the surface of the sea and the ocean, water will evaporate from the sea surface or from the ocean surface at the normal temperature. Temperature usually is 20 or 30. So this will form the clouds, and the clouds, by the will of Allah, will receive it as rains or fresh water. So I will take only 2 minutes. The condensation is the opposite of vaporization. It's a change from gas to a liquid. And this will happen at the condensation point, which has the same temperature as the boiling point. So the boiling point and condensation point are the same, but it's the reverse. It's the reversed process. The last one is called sublimation. Last one is called sublimation. What is the sublimation? It's the change from solid directly to a gas. So solid changes directly to a gas without going through the liquid state. Give me examples. The best example of sublimation is the dry ice. Dry ice is actually CO2, carbon dioxide. They put it under and in very low temperature, so they change it into solid. course, that's artificial. They make it in some factories. Okay. And because it has very low temperature, the temperature of the dry ice is -78.5. So they use it as ice. They use it to cool down the stuff. Okay. And we call it dry ice. When dry ice increases its temperature, what happens? Or when you give it heat, or when it absorbs heat, actually, when it absorbs heat, what will happen? It will change directly into gas. So it changes directly into CO2 gas again without going to state. So there is no liquid CO2 here. We have only solid and gas. It's called sublimation.